Good evening, everyone. Is this on? Welcome. My name is Raka Ray. I'm chair of the Center for South Asia Studies at Berkeley, and with Ananya Roy, co-chair of the Berkeley India Initiative. It's my very great pleasure to introduce to you today Sudha Murty, chairperson of Infosys Foundation. Mrs. Murty is known simultaneously for her academic accomplishments and for her philanthropy. Her first rank in MTech computer science from the prestigious Indian Institute of Science in Bangalore was only one of the very many national recognitions Sudha Murty has received for her academic work. And this medal that she received was in 1974, when not very many women ventured into engineering or computer science. Indeed, one of the most famous stories about Sudha Murty is the story of how she went to work for Telco, now Tata Motors, which she did for many years. As a student at the IIS, in the Indian Institute of Science, which was then called the Tata Institute, young Sudha came across an ad for a job posted by Telco, which stated the requirements of a job applicant and then added, "Lady candidates need not apply." She dashed off a postcard to the legendary JRD Tata, protesting against the discrimination. 10 days later, she was invited for an interview. But even then, the interview process was not smooth for the young Sudha Murty from Hubli, Karnataka, for she was told by a kindly interviewer on the interviewing panel that she was no doubt very qualified and very talented, but women surely belonged in a research lab and not in a factory. But she persisted. "But you must start somewhere, otherwise no woman will ever be able to work in your factories," she said. And the job was hers. She worked for Telco until her husband, Narayana Murthy, decided to start Infosys, and the rest is history. An active working engineer for many years, Mrs. Murthy is now an educationist, philanthropist, and author. Among other things, she has initiated a move to provide all government schools in Karnataka with computer and library facilities. Infosys Foundation has done wonderful work in education, rural development, healthcare, and the arts. A prolific writer in English and Kannada, she has written 9 novels, 4 technical books, 3 travelogues, 1 collection of short stories, and 3 collections of non-fiction pieces. Her books have been translated into all the major Indian languages and have sold many hundreds of thousands of copies. She was awarded the Padmashree in 2006, as well as many other awards for philanthropy and literature. It is our special pleasure to have Sudha Murty here because her work stands at the intersection of what we do best at Berkeley. We bring the best of our knowledge to bear to help create a better, more equitable, and decent world. At Berkeley, we've recently launched the Berkeley India Initiative to deepen our ties to Indian institutions so that UC Berkeley and the great Indian institutions can work together to deepen our knowledge of classical and contemporary India. With regard to contemporary India, we work to collaboratively create solutions to the social, economic, and environmental problems that India faces. The co-sponsor of today's talk is CITRIS, the Center for Information Technology Research in the Interest of Society, which is a model for the sort of collaborative work that Berkeley does with India. I'd also like to mention the Blum Center for Developing Economies, of which the Dean of the College of Engineering, Shankar Shastri, is faculty director, and of which Ananya Roy, here today, is curriculum director, which has a newly created minor in global poverty. Thus, we are particularly appreciative in this institution of the importance and impact of Sudha Murty's work, in recognition of which we at UC Berkeley would like to add to her growing list of awards by presenting her with the UC Berkeley International and Area Studies Global Leaders Award in recognition of her outstanding work in the areas of poverty alleviation and social change in India. I'd like to invite Paul Gray up to the podium to hand this award to Sudha Murty.
Thank you.
Sudha Murty.
Congratulations.
Thank you very much.
It's an honor to give you this, and it's an honor to have you. It's an honor to have you at Berkeley.
Thank you.
And now I will turn the podium over to Sudha Murty herself, and she's going to speak on A Philanthropist Speaks, Lessons from Life. Please join me in welcoming Sudha Murty. I think you have the mic, sir.
Okay. Distinguished people, I did visit Berkeley maybe 29 years back. My brother was a student in Department of Astrophysics here, and Berkeley is one of the outstanding university. The testimony of that is he did his PhD from Berkeley, my brother, and straightway he went to Caltech and got tenure within a year and a half or something, 2 years. He said Berkeley was the best university. I have a great memory when he was here as a student. I used to come here and spend some time, particularly the library. You know, I used to spend a lot of my time in the library. That time there was no internet. I'm talking 1978-79 time. I also met Chitra Dinukarni, who was a student of English literature here, and later she became a very famous writer. I have great memories of this city, this Berkeley University. And later I was not able to make it. Only this is the occasion, long time I'm coming. Thank you once again giving me this award. I really do not know whether I deserve it or not, because sometimes I feel what work I have done, really that distinguished work. Maybe anybody in my position would have done the same, because if you love your country, you do that work. That's as simple as that. I was telling Professor Ray that I hardly come out of my country, because my work is only in my country. I don't work anywhere else. Not even in neighbor Bangladesh or Sri Lanka. I don't even work. I work only in India. And that's true in 6 states, not more. And we have different problems every day. Like, sometimes we save money so that we can do some other development work, but that year there will be a calamity. Like in the last 10 years, there are 8 calamities. You know, Gujarat earthquake, there was tsunami, then there were riots in Gujarat, and then again floods in Orissa, drought in Karnataka and Maharashtra. So every year I think either we are in the floods or in the drought or some natural disaster. And our work requires tremendous amount of time and passion, you know. So I'm always in the villages, so maybe 10 days or 8 days I come to city and clean all my close and go back. Somebody asked me today when I was reading a lecture at Stanford that your husband talks about corporate, how to make profit, and what is the GDP, but you talk in a different language. I said, my domain is so different, my customers are so different, my interaction with them is so different than the big city or the corporate world. Though we get money from corporate houses, okay, that's the main source of income. Actually, I'm not going to talk about what is philanthropy, why one should do, etc., or definition and all. I want to tell what I have learned from philanthropy and which has affected me personally in my real life. And that made me to write all my experiences in 3 non-fiction books, that is, Wise and Otherwise. I say that I'm good in my work, otherwise I really do not know what the outside world. And second one is The Old Man and His God, that I discovered my country only through poor people. Otherwise, I did not know. I knew my country has so many states, so different languages, different food patterns, all those things. But I really realized what India is. It's only through my work, and that is through poor people. They taught me great lessons. That is Old Man and His God. Third one is how I taught my grandmother to read. That is my personal thing. My grandmother was illiterate, and at the age of 62, she started learning, and that gave me a motivation in life that if you want to achieve anything in life, age is no bar, it's your mindset. Some of them I want to talk today, that what philanthropy taught me and which changed my mindset. You know, I was a full-fledged professor in Bangalore University in computer science, and things were right on my side. My husband was doing very well in his business, and one day my daughter, that time she was 15 years old, She used to read for a blind child. You know, she was a scriber. There was a blind boy and she used to write on his behalf in the examination. She was a scriber. And she came and told me that that boy by the name Anand Shah, he wants to join St. Stephen's College in Delhi. It is a very prestigious and expensive college. Being bright, he would have got seat, but being poor, it was difficult for him to maintain. I was very busy as head of the department in Bangalore. You know, in the Indian universities, when you're head of the department, you do administration as well as academic both. So I was very busy in setting up the question paper because that's a big thing in India, and number of students will not be like 20, 30, we have thousands of students. So you have to have the secrecy and all those papers should be kept inside, etc. So in a, you know, I was so much worried about the examination. So I told my daughter, oh, you can sponsor or something. And she told me, where do I have money? Because you don't give any pocket money. And you, whatever we want, you buy. You don't even give 10 rupee or a dollar in my hand. And how can I sponsor? And she told me, she made a remark. She was only 15 and she made a remark. Amma, that's the way how South Indians call their mother. Amma, she said, you are a well-read, well-traveled and educated lady. If you do not want to do any social work, then you don't have a right to talk about anybody about social work. What's your duty in life? What are you looking forward in life? Is it glory or glamour or money? What's that? What makes you to work? And she was upset and she went away, and I went to the university examination center with my books in my hand. Because if somebody studies in India, they understand we have two examinations, one in October and the other in April. What questions appear in October should not appear in April. That's what to take care. Okay? Otherwise, you lose your post. So I was very busy in eliminating the questions of the October. I went to the Senate Hall, I sat there, and my mind did not concentrate on question paper. I said, really speaking, what am I looking in life? It is not a daughter of 15 who has asked me. I questioned that one to myself. Everybody should question sometime in their life, what am I doing? For whom do I doing? And what is the ultimate aim in my life? Am I in the same direction or some other direction? When I questioned that, I went on thinking about my own life. I was 45 years old that time. I said, first 25 years I worked for the academic excellence of my own career. I should never get a second rank. I should be all at the top in the list. I never bothered about anything else. Next 20 years I worked for Infosys. You know, it's the beginning because it's a company started with $250 with absolutely no money, and six enthusiastic people started the company. And I was a programmer when there was no programmer. I was an accountant. I was a secretary. Call any job, I am there except a chairman post. So, and two small children, save every penny so that company should prosper. Always think the betterment of the company than your individual. The 20 years I spent without going anywhere else. It's only you have to save money and bring the company up. I know company is doing fairly well. Children have grown up. And I don't require to excel in anything in academy at the age of 45. I was not also in the academic line that time. So I was thinking, what is my aim in life? And I felt it. I felt sincerely that what I have done to my own country. I made good money, I have a good name, I'm a very well-read person, I travel a lot. That's all my personal thing, but what have I done to my country? The country where I am born, the country which is poor, the country where there are all extremes are there, very rich people, very poor people, and majority of them are poor. And they stay in below poverty line, rural area. What have I done? To be born in a rich family is not your desire, you are born there, or to be well-educated, a good family where you get education. It is not that you work for it, but you get it because you are born. I was born in a family of professors. My father was a professor and a doctor. He helped, I mean, he was encouraged all the time that you should study well. I was not from a rich family, but extremely academic oriented family. But someone who has a better quality than me is born, you know, after that unknown line of the poverty line. And that person, what is his or her fault? Why that person has to be born there and lose all the opportunity just because someone is poor? I went on thinking about that next 8 days. Then I decided, if God is kind to me and gives me good health, I will not work for Infosys, I will not work for my children, I will not work for myself. I will work only for the poorest of the poor in India. That's my mission. And that's the way I thought of philanthropy on my personal level. I said, I have to work because I have an obligation to my country, my society. And I'm not in any dilemma, or I'm not in that hypothetical assumption that I will eliminate poverty. No, I don't have, because there are many reasons why people are poor. There are many reasons why people do not want to get out of it. There are many reasons why it continues. In my lifetime, what I can do to reduce the suffering of at least some section of the society, I think that's enough for me. I don't want any reward or award or fame in that. Rewards and awards came accidentally with the work, but that was never my aim. My aim was that I must help people because it's my sheer duty, nothing else. It is nothing great. I'm doing anything extraordinary. It has to be done that way. I did not know word how to start philanthropy, what to talk to when the clients come. Our clients are not intelligent. I mean, they are intelligent, but they are not rich people. They are poor. That's why they come to us. They come and sit in front of us. And in 15 minutes in an interview, I must decide the person is telling lie. I'm talking about my experiences in India. They are different in US. They are different in different countries. My experiences in my country, people may tell lie. People may tell truth. They may manipulate the words. I do not know. So when person comes and sits in front of me, I should measure the person's difficulties. Is it true or false? If it is true, what extent I can help? If I'm going to help, then what are the different ways to help? And how long I can help? How do I know how to do all those things? And there is no book on this. There is no teacher on this. It's only by experience. And I did not have any experience. I sat first day in Infosys Foundation. I was wondering, am I coming in the right place or wrong place? Is it an emotional decision? Because I resigned my post as head of the Department of Computer Science. I became only a mere lecturer, and that is through 3 hours a week, three credit course. That's all I will take, I told them. Because I like teaching, I like to interact with youngsters. I don't want to lose teaching ability. So I was thinking, you know, all alone sitting in my office, that what am I doing? Is it the right thing? How will I be able to measure the difficulties of others unless you understand it? How to understand that? One method is you should suffer, or you should stay or with such people or interact with such people more often so that you will have 80% of that knowledge. That's how I started my touring in a leprosy colony, sex workers, street children, runaway children from home, orphanage, old age home, name a thing, everything. I said, I must understand their difficulties. Why do they do like this? What is the solution for that? And that opened a new door for me to understand what India is. Until that, for me, India is a country with several states. Those are the capitals. These are the languages. These are the costumes. These are the food. Okay, all those things. But when I realized, all of them are connected by one simple principle. All of them are poor. With whom I work, they are all poor. They all need help. They all need, you know, different people need different type of help. For example, I work with sex workers. The most difficult job in my work is working with sex workers in India. They are not open because they are really, you know, bitter about the experiences. And they don't want to talk to you. Actually, it took for me 3 years to have a dialogue with them. And at the end, every workers tell me, I don't want money from you. I want a patient hearing. Why I got into this sex trade or sex working area? It was not our desire. We have been cheated many times. We have been sold. And everybody wants a patient hearing. And they want this word at the end, it was not your fault. Everybody wants that sympathetic word, it was not your fault. When you work with students, you require different. When you work with housewives, you require different kind of a mindset. So it opened a door to me, and greatest lessons I learned in my life from the poorest of the poor people. No university taught me, no book taught me, nobody taught me, but poorest of the poor taught me the great lessons. I'll even give an example. I was about 9 years back, I was working in Tamil Nadu. And it was November, month of November, and you get mid-November rains, heavy rains, because if there is a depression in Bay of Bengal, you get rains in Tamil Nadu. I was traveling by car, and my car, as usual, when you don't want the car, gets spoiled, you know. In somewhere, 8 o'clock in the night, the car did not move, and my driver said it takes another hour and a half to get it repaired. It was pouring. He said, you find out some place and you rest there, and I will be back after 2 hours. I said, okay. I took an umbrella and it drenched. I saw a small temple, you know, it's a small village. I went inside, and I was wondering what to do, because Tamil Nadu people speak Tamil and I can't speak Tamil. In India, to do our work, you require 5-6 languages. But my knowledge of Tamil is poor, whereas I can speak Marathi, Konkani, to some extent Bengali, some extent Oriya, great extent Hindi, you know, all those things, but not Tamil. I said, doesn't matter. Many times I realized, you know, when people want to converse with you, if you can do not know language, you converse through your heart. You tell whatever you want to tell, they tell in your language, they will tell in their language, but you understand that. I said, okay, let me go. And I sat there. It was one of the Shiva temple. India has many gods. Shiva is one of the prominent gods. And it was night. There was no lamps. It was only an oil lamp. And it was so quiet. I saw husband and wife. Husband was blind. He was almost 80 years. And his wife was there. And he said, can I do some puja? That's the way how we do worship our God. And I said, okay, you do. When he did that, I gave him 100 rupee bill, because I knew they were very poor. And he touched, because he was blind, he can't see. He said, oh, it's more than 10. I said, no, it doesn't matter, keep it with you. Then I told him, anyway, 1.5 hours I have to spend being a teacher, being a lady, I speak, being a writer, I talk more. Okay, talk to the power of three. So I said, okay, let me converse with him. So I asked him, then he says he doesn't have any children, they are an old couple, they are in that village for a long time. And he does the puja every day, and he gets some money from the villagers, and he's doing okay. I felt very bad. This man is 80 years old, and any disease can come to him. Who will support him? He doesn't have any children. So I told him, I will go back to Bangalore, and I didn't tell my name. Actually, it's good, many times I should not tell my name, because people's expectation also changes in India. So I said, I'll go back and I'll send you some money. You keep that money in the nationalized bank, and every month you get some interest, so that it will be useful to you in case you fall sick. He said, I don't know, child, I don't know who you are, but I want to tell you something. He said, in life, you should say somewhere enough. Draw a line saying that enough is enough, and I don't require your money. Actually, in my work, I hardly come across someone like that. People who come to me, if I give ₹500,000, they say, oh, it was such a small amount, she could have given 2 million. Somebody calls me for something else at the end, they will ask some other money, something else. You know, I go to school or college inauguration, at the end there is always an appeal to me, Mrs. Murty, will you do this project, or will you give this money? Sometimes you are able to give, sometimes you are not able to give. Depending on the project, it's pure merit basis. When you don't give, people get upset, they don't even call you next time, even though they meet, they won't even call. People who get also are very upset with me, because they ask something, they get only 10% of that. So either way, I have more enemies. Here is the old man who doesn't know who I am, and he tells me, I don't want any money from you. He says, I am old. If you give money, I'll keep it in the bank. Now all these days his villagers have fed me, because I do some puja, so they come and give me rice. We are living like this. Now the moment everybody comes and I kept the money in the bank, then there'll be some thief, he'll be behind me. I'm blind, when I'm taking it here, he will harm. And the other people will feel, anyway, this old man has money, why should we help him? Whole equilibrium will be lost. And child, I'm 80 years old. I really feel I don't require anything, because I'm contented in my heart. Any amount of money cannot be traded with money. Content cannot be traded with money. Somewhere in life, you have to draw a line. I don't need, and I have drawn that line. Don't disturb my equilibrium. I may not agree with all his principles, because if we are the line of content in a very young age, then I will not study at all. I'll be at home. I'm very contented. If I'm in my, if we have started with Infosys, with the content, we would not have grown. But somewhere, he said, that is true. Somewhere in life, you have to draw a line and say goodbye. I learned the great lesson, and I said, that's the greatest lesson in my life, is I must draw a line somewhere to say I don't need these things. And I drew a line at that time. I said, okay, these are the things I don't require in my life, and I don't have regrets for that. A line or a content within yourself is the most important lesson one should learn, And without that, you are always behind unknown, an unknown horse which is always galloping, and you go behind that. You don't know where it takes you. I was working in Kalahandi, which is very famous for all the diseases in the world. You go there and it's difficult to come back because there's always galloping jaundice. They say 36 hours you die. Okay, it's very dangerous. So normally to reach Kalahandi, you have to go to Bhuneshwar. To reach Bhuneshwar, you have to take two flights before. And you get down there and take a train. And there is no express train. Even though there is an express train, every tribal person stops the train and gets in without ticket. Because it's a tribal area. And nobody can question anybody because everybody's language is different, everybody's life is different. Then you get down a place known as the Bhavanipatana, and then you take a jeep. 14 kilometers you have to road by jeep. And then there is a river. You have to cross the river, ferry the river actually. And then you have to walk 7 kilometers. Then you reach this Kalahandi. I mean, in the interior jungles of Kalahandi. Kalahandi starts after Bhavanipatana also. But interior where we used to work, you have to go deep inside. It takes all kinds of transport, a train, a ferry, jeep, and then you have to walk. I met an old man there. Someone said he's 102 years old. And in that entire tribal area, everybody's hair was jet black. And when they saw my hair, they asked me, what do you apply to your hair to become grey hair? 70 plus, everyone has jet black grey hair. I knew they can't afford to have a dyeing facility because they're really poor people. And they were surprised that I have something unusual silver color, so what I must have done. So I was talking to him. I felt very strange when I met a man of 102, good health and good memory. I said, let me ask him some questions. I said, who is ruling India? He said, East India Company. That means he's not even aware India is independent. Then I asked him, who is our Prime Minister? He says, Goriwali Rani. That means a fair-skinned queen. That is Queen Victoria. And his answers were so different than my imagination. And I've never met anyone like that in my work, Someone who belongs to 100 years old back and your knowledge 200 years back. Then I showed him a currency, Indian currency, and I showed him and said, it's an important piece of paper because currency he won't understand. If you take this paper, you can trade. He said, what can I get to this paper? I told him, you can buy matchsticks. That is very difficult in the tribal area. You can buy clothes and all those things. He laughed at me. And he said, okay, you have quizzed me so many questions. Now I will ask you one simple question. I said, okay, I'm thinking of this man from Kalahandi. What he will ask me? Let me see. Sometimes you underestimate people, They are so smart. He said, what is not yours? If you take it, is it not a theft? I said, of course it is theft. When this is not mine and if you take it, it is theft. He says, look at this beautiful area, Kalahandi, or the Orissa. If anyone is from Orissa, they understand it's a beautiful place. Nature is very kind there. You have so many riverlets, beautiful forest, thick forest. He says, rain comes on its own, doesn't ask your permission. River flows on its own, doesn't ask my permission. This land is created by God. The trees come on their own. You people from the city, come here. Cut the trees. Trade this land for this piece of paper and give to somebody. When this land doesn't belong to you, how can you trade this land? It's not yours. Are you not a thief? And actually it struck me that in life, just because we trade, we think it's, we know everything. But the man from Kalahandi told me, nature is a gift of the God and we are trading it for our own selfish motive. I said, I did not have any answer to tell him. I said, the great wisdom comes from such people who have seen enough in life. I can give you many experiences where I felt I really do not know in front of them. I was working in a leprosy colony in one of the remote area in Karnataka. And then I wanted to count how many women are there, that many are, I wanted to give them something to wear or something, some help I wanted to give. I was counting and one person said, there's a lady inside the hut and her name is some lady, Gangamma or something. I said, no, unless I see the person, I can't list. Because by this time I learned people tell lie. So, but let me check. Then I called her name in her dialect. She did not come. I said, okay, she didn't come. Let me go inside and meet her. I went inside. In a minute, I came outside. The reason was, it was a dark hut. There was no light. I mean, of course, afternoon I went. There was a lady, and she was sitting like this. She did not have any clothes on her body. And she told me, Amma, you called, told me to come out and tell my name. I didn't come because I'm a lady. I can't come without clothes. I'm so poor, I don't have a piece of cloth with me to cover my body. I sat there, and that was in the early years of my foundation. I started crying. I said, what is the use of independence? Dollars, billion dollars, Bollywood music, we talk all those things. Here is my country where after 55 years of independence, that time it was 55 years of independence, a woman is not to come out because she doesn't have a set of clothes to cover her body. Not expensive clothes, an ordinary cloth to cover her body. What is my country? What it means to me? And I started crying there. And then of course, you know, I had my own bag and my sari I gave her. Something I did. That struck me so much. I said, if I say my country is progressing, in that case, in my country, everybody should get 2 square meals a day. In my country, children should study up to the 12th class. In my country, women should have a set of cloth, 2 sets of clothes actually, one to wear and one to have clean. And then only I call my country has progressed. Otherwise, I will not call my country has progressed. And such people give me inspiration in life to I should work, I must work for those people, not for any other award or reward. If they come, it's well and good. If they don't come, still it's okay. But I have to work for such people. They are my source of inspiration because they belong to my country. I have an obligation towards them. In my work also, many times I have been cheated, though we are very careful when we talk, when we do, we don't promise immediately. We said, we'll think it over, we'll get back. One day, one person came and told me that his son is suffering from cancer, young child. Then I said, I want a proof. Without proof, we don't give money. He said, okay, he'll bring proof. Next day, he brought the child only. The child, you know, stomach was bulged, and the child was suffering, and I could see. I said, no, don't bring the child now. I said, okay. He says, I require 2 lakhs, that means 200,000 rupees. 200,000 rupees is maybe, I don't know how many dollars, you should tell, divided by 40. Is $5,000 maybe? $5,000. He said, I require $5,000 for the operation. I said, that much we can't give because we do get many applications. Maybe I will give 25,000 rupees, maybe $1,250. $1,250 I will give. The rest you collect from everybody. He said, he thought for a minute, he said, okay, no problem. But will you give me a letter that this so-and-so is suffering from cancer and Infosys Foundation has given $1,250 for the treatment of the child? I said, okay, that is not a problem because he can produce that letter and get some money. There is nothing wrong in that. So we give the money, we give the letter. And normally I computerize everything, you know, whatever work we do. Maybe because my background is computer and that helps me a lot. Because everything is so systematic, nothing is ad hoc. Or nothing is that, oh, I gave on such and such a day when it was raining, I gave it on such and such a day and Mrs. Murty was here. Nothing of that. Every day, every appeal, the name of the person who has appealed, what kind of treatment, what the cause, how much money you have given, and action for that. So action column I wrote, check after 6 months. That's the action I wrote. And after 6 months, it started beeping, saying that you have not taken action. Then I said, okay, he told me he'll get operated in such an hospital. I called up the hospital. By this time, you know, like how finance people have their network, even social entrepreneurs have their own networks, you know. We know the hospitals, we know the old age homes, we know the adoption agencies, we know orphanages, we know street children where they sleep, we know where they take drugs. So we also know where the dens are there, what time, who is available where, all those things. We also have our own networking. So I called up that hospital and asked, is there any patient by this name who was operated in the last 6 months? They said, no, I have not heard. Then I said, maybe he might have got operated somewhere else because that is not the only hospital. But I had his address. I said, okay, let me go and see. This habit of checking always helped me in my life. I went to that person's house and house was locked. And it was a 3-story building. The house was locked. I was wondering whether I came to the right address or did he give a wrong address? What I should do? Then there was a lady, old lady sitting next door. And India is a country where lot of talking and social activities are very important than food. In India, we can starve one meal, but we can't stop talking, because that is a great relief to us in all our tensions. It's also we share our grief with others. The greatest difficulty when I come to the West is that people don't talk. I feel, something is wrong with me, I feel that kind, In India, we talk a lot, and at times it's good, many times it's bad also. So this old lady said, oh, who are you, why have you come? Then I said, no, I have come to this fellow house, his house is locked. He said, no, it's same house, come inside and, she immediately called me. I also went. I said, because I wanted to know what has happened. Then she told me, I said, what happened to that fellow's son? His name was Somappa, actually. Somappa, what happened to that child? Old lady opened her book. Okay, she said, her daughter-in-law's holding, no, don't talk, but she continued telling me. There's a foolish lady by the name Sudha Murty in Bangalore. It seems she gave him $1,250 and a letter, because in India, we can't also keep secrecy. Okay? Secret. Everybody should know everybody's house details. Okay. There is a lady by the name Sudha Murty who is very foolish. She gave him money and also she gave a letter. Somappa's father used that letter, went from one organization to another organization, saying that Sudha Murty has given a letter and have a good reputation that normally I verify very well before I give. Someone says if Mrs. Murty has given, then we can give, because she is that hard task master. She must have taken all the care precaution. Then only she gives. So he has gone to Azim Premji Foundation or the Wipro or some other foundation. I don't know where this fellow went. So he has gone to many foundations and everybody has given some money. So he collected more money than $5,000, because if he goes to 10 good foundations with my letter, he must have collected. Then he thought over it. Anyway, the child is going to die. Why operate the child? Instead, it's a real life story. I'm not imagining anything. I have seen, I'm a witness. Instead, he invested that $5,000 in 2 or 3 auto rickshaws. There is a rickshaw we have in our country. You must have seen, auto rickshaw, a lakh of 100,000 or 80,000 you get auto rickshaw. He ran a good business. And the child died. The child died without treatment. He made money and built 3-story building. Or already it was there, he got it repaired or something. I stood there motionless. I said, where did I go wrong? Was it wrong on my part to give a letter? Was it wrong on my part to give $1,250? Was it because of my mistake the child died? Where did I go wrong? I went on thinking about it. Where did I go wrong? Then I felt it is not I went wrong. To be compassionate is the most essential thing in life. There's nothing wrong. Otherwise, if I don't have compassion, I can't do philanthropy. If I'm a very calculative, hard-minded person, I cannot do philanthropy, because in philanthropy you have to be compassionate. You should care for others. Giving a letter was a mistake. It was not. But the person took advantage of the situation. Being a father, he did not get treatment for his child because he felt it's not important. It is not my mistake. It is the person who received was so crooked, and you can't measure anybody's mind. So there's a place where, I went wrong. And there are many places where I have gone wrong. And every time when I go wrong, I correct myself and question this, where did I go wrong? About 7 years back, I was in my office and Monday morning is hectic and one person comes. One young man, about 30, 35 years old man comes. With another old person who around 70, he says, madam, I saw this fellow on the bus stop, he was crying. He had a plastic bag in his hand. This old man had a plastic bag in his hand. And he tells that you, Infosys Foundation, people help others, and I read about that in the paper. And here the old man crying on the bus stop, I brought him. Then, do you have any old age home? I said, yes, we do have. And how do you know him? He said, I don't know him, I just met him. And I brought him. And he left him. And I said, yes, we have old age home. Maybe I will talk to him. And maybe if it's needed, we'll put him in the old age home. Because he didn't have anybody. And I talked to the old man and I asked him, do you have anybody? You have any children? He did not talk. He said, no. First he said, no. And he started crying. Do you have any money? He said, no, I don't have. Then I felt bad. He's 70 years old. Best is that, okay, let's put him in an old age home and we'll pay for it. It doesn't matter. Not that we'll do it for everybody, but in case it's really bad, we do that once in a while. I said, okay, I sent him to, with my assistant, I sent him to an old age home, which I know. Then you keep this fellow until, He was not feeling well until he's all right. Later we'll see what can be done. And this young man left. After 6 months or 7 months, I get a call from the old age home. Every month I used to send some money. It's not a big one, maybe 2,000 rupees. By how much it was? $50 maybe. The person whom you have sent is not well. He's on a deathbed. Will you come? Immediately I went. Because in India, when you are alive, people may help or may not help. But when you die, it's very important how he should be cremated. Suppose he is cremated in his own religion, it's good. Otherwise, there will be a problem later. That was my main worry. I went there and doctor said, this fellow may not survive. He's really unwell. I said, no, whatever medicine will pay, said, you may pay, but he's really not well. Then I asked him, you know, that does he have anybody? Because when a person is dying, he will have a nephew, he will have a friend, he will have somebody. You are not born like that, and you will, particularly in India, you won't die like that. At least your neighbor will be there, or your servant will be there, somebody will be there. He gave some telephone number, it was there below his bed, and we called up, and somebody came. And that one young man came, and then he went inside, and probably he was talking to the old man, and the old man died. Young man came, and started crying. I said, I looked at him, I said, I've seen you somewhere. He said, no, I have not met you. I said, normally, I'm good. I'm normally good in remembering things. Maybe of late even I'm growing old with a silver line. I said, maybe. But I have seen you somewhere. Then he says, he didn't reply. He said, this old man had a plastic bag. Where is that bag? Then I said, I know you, I told him. How do you know that old man had a plastic bag? There's nothing, there was no information. How did you know? That means you know old man before when he came, because I knew that he had a plastic bag. I said, not only that, I won't even use that bag, but I will call police to know who are you, why did you come, why are you asking. You have to become tough also in philanthropy at times. Then he was scared. He said, I came to know that. Then he told his story. This fellow who came was old man's son. And he never wanted to keep his father at home, because there was a fight between his wife and the father. Now the best way to palm off the father is through Infosys Foundation. Here is the lady who helps people. Just tell her a story, make a story at that moment. I don't know him. And he brought his father, and I put him in, at our expense, he was in the old age home. It doesn't matter what expense, $50 into 6 months or 7 months is $350, $400, it's not that. Look at the attitude. And now he comes because that old man had a passbook and which showed some amount of money. And look at that old man, he writes that man, nominee, his son's name. He doesn't even write Infosys Foundation name, because we have helped him. It's not that we want his money. We really don't want his money. I said, look at this man. His son doesn't pay his bills. Somebody else pays. When he's dying, he wants his son as a nominee. What a cruel world. I don't want that money. Then I told him, either you should have a culture when you say the man is old, we'll put him in an old age home, we'll pay for him. There's nothing wrong in that, because old age home, you also get old people of their companionship. It's a nice way of spending old time, old age time. Or keep your father like an Indian tradition and look after him until he dies and take his money. You are worst of the both worlds, I told him. You want money and you don't want to keep your father. And that time I was thinking, standing there, what is the meaning of human relationship between a son and a father, or an institution and the receivers? What are these things? Is money that important? Is relationships are that important? Where are we going wrong? Or how we are taking advantage of the situation? There are many instances where I question, you know, where I am going wrong, or what makes people to do these things. There are many good incidents, there are many bad incidents. But life has taught me one lesson. What time I should complete? 5:15, right? Or any question answers are there? Okay, then I'll finish at 5. What time I should finish? Yes, you should tell me exactly.
In 10 minutes?
Being a teacher, you know, in India, I don't know what's in Berkeley. In India, when we give our sermon or class, 45 minutes is the class. Until the next bell rings, then you have to stop your class, then you have to go out. So I'm so much used to, that until the bell rings, I might continue. And I don't want to do that. I don't know, Berkeley, you have the bell or no bell?
No bell.
Okay, then I really will continue whole day, I think, morning to evening. No, in our college we have bell. I'm sure if you're studying in India, you understand that the bell rings and children will run and we'll also go. The class is over. They will look at that exit door, I will look at this exit door. So, there are many incidents also have brought me tremendous joy. Tremendous joy that no word can tell that. I cannot write, my pen fails. I can't type on the computer, my words fall short of it. tremendous joy, the joy which I never got in the, when Infosys stock went up, or when I made money, or when I got all these awards. More than that, you know, there was a child which ran away from home. And when I normally travel by second class train in India, because that's the best place to meet poor people. I was traveling by train and one child came, around 10 years old child, and he was so poor, he took his shirt and started cleaning, you know, the berth, let's say, compartment. I felt very bad. I said, come here, what's your name? Then he said, no, I don't want to talk to you. Actually, these runaway children never talk to you because they're so much worried, you know. And they have all wrong concept that I will tell the police will beat them up, or I will, you know, something will happen. They never ever open up. So I said, no, no, you know, I told him, I will not tell anybody, tell me. And, you know, I gave him, my husband had one extra shirt. I said, okay, let me give you, though it's a big size, it doesn't matter. Then I gave him, okay, I will give you food, I will get you chocolate. You know, it's anyway a 14 hours journey, I can become friendly, you know, and 3-4 hours I cajoled him. And then he told me that in his house he has fought with his parents. And, you know, he went to take bath along with his brother in a pond. And, you know, in that fight, the brother fell in the pond. This child of 10 years assumed, I mean, that time he was 9, 1 year later I met him. His brother has died, okay? He said, my brother drowned and he must have died. Father will come to know, he will beat me up. So I ran away from home. I said, how do you know he has died? He said, no, I know, because my brother did not know swimming, etc. I'm so scared. I said, fine, that's fine, you know, you should not react to them immediately. I said, where do you stay? Then, you know, there's a place, these children travel without ticket 200 kilometers a day. They get on some junction like Asansol junction to Howrah to, you know, Jamshedpur, that kind of thing, you know. They go long distance and begging, sometimes cleaning, sometimes getting, I mean, their life is very, very pathetic actually. If ever you travel in India by train, if you meet these children, please understand there is a long story for every child. So, I told him, okay, I said, his junction came and, you know, he got down and he told me he stays near waiting room. They don't have any house to stay, they eat there and all. I said, fine. And I asked him which place he came and he gave me some name. I was not sure they told me truth or no. Then anyway, I was going to that area. As soon as I got down from my destination place, you know, I told my person who came with me, you go and find out in that basti or that hutment, is there any lady by the name Ellamma whose son has ran away, and I will wait outside, because the moment I will ask, they think, well, who am I, why am I asking, so send somebody. And in case the mother says yes, and tell her that I want to meet her. So that person who was with me went and told her that there is a lady Ellamma and she has 2 children and 1 has ran away. She said yes, and said somebody knows, and immediately she came. I asked her first question, what happened to your second child? She says, he's alive. And I said, when did your first son run away? What, a year back? So, does your second child fell in a pond? She said, yes, it fell. But somebody picked him up and he came. Everything was all right. Then I told her, you know, I know where your son is there. And will you come? And she was, they were so poor. She said, you tell me anything I will do for my son. But I want to meet him. I don't know where he is. The way she started crying, it was, you know, it's so difficult to console. They were very poor, very poor. And she did not have money even for the train. I said, okay. There's the next train available, and I said, I'll come with you immediately, let's go. Another overnight journey. The person who came with me said, ma'am, you can't go, you have come for some function, people are waiting. I said, no, you know, my talk doesn't mean much, you know, it doesn't matter. But the mother's agony I cannot say. I said, if it is not an important thing, after all I have to talk to some students or something, tell them tomorrow night I will do it. Normally my meetings are with the students or the poor people, and they understand. Poor people understand difficulties faster than other people. Said that she is really stuck somewhere, she will come tomorrow, but definitely. Immediately I took a train, I went with her, and this boy was there. And when the mother met boy, this her child, I did not have a photo, you know, camera actually. Even the camera would fail. The kind of happiness both of them showed. And she told me, I'm ever grateful to you. You brought this child. I said, no, I did not. It happened that way. And this, I continued with them, my friendship with them. And this child wanted to study. Later we helped. We helped this child, and today he's a software engineer somewhere. And what I'm telling you this story is that one small assumption that his brother is dead. The child was scared, child ran away, child came back, and a bright child. Around 1 year he spent on the railway platform cleaning the, you know, the berths and, you know, begging, and the child studied later and did very well. I can give numerous examples where children I have met in such an occasion and how their life has transformed. It is not me. It is, there are many charity organizations, they are like that. They come across these people, help them. Once I know about 9 years back, I think, I was in some village and I wanted to make a telephone call. We didn't have a cell phone in India at that time. So there was a telephone booth, thanks to Sam Pitroda, he made telephone booth on all highways. I went to a telephone booth to tell my mother, because when I travel, once in 3 days I have to call home and to tell I'm fine, don't worry, because I'm also, they think running away child, she won't come back only if she goes 8 days. So there's a rule that if I'm in a disaster, I have to call once a day. If I'm not in a disaster, at least once in 3 days I should call and tell I'm fine. Now there's a cell phone, I can call anywhere if the network is available. I went to call and there was a girl, around 17 years girl, in torn clothes, and she opened the door and she started cleaning the telephone, etc. And as usual, you book a call, the call doesn't come and the line will be cut. In India, there's all hassle, but hassle is also pleasure because you can talk to people that time. So it is not efficient, but inefficiency also has its own advantage. So the line did not get connected to my mother, so I was sitting there. Then I started talking to her, her name was Pooja. When I talk to her, maybe Pooja may be listening if it's on a web somewhere else today. And if she listens, I'll be very happy actually. I said, Pooja, tell me about you. She said, I don't have parents, my both parents are dead. I have a grandmother and who does help her in some houses and gets hardly about 200, 300 rupees. And I said, what have you done? She said, I appeared for the 10th class. That's India's matriculation we call. And the results have come yesterday only. I scored some 90%. And I said, you must study further. She says, but ma'am, this itself was so difficult. It's a free school. I did. It's a public school. How will you expect me to study further? My grandmother is old. I don't have anybody else in life. Maybe I should do some work so that my grandmother can take rest. And meantime, my call got connected. And I was thinking, there are many children like Pooja in our country who are so bright. I may or may not meet them. Here's the bright girl. I said, okay, Pooja, on one ground, on one condition, I will help you. I don't know her at all. Tomorrow, I will stay one more day here. I will come to your school where you have studied and I will meet your principal. If things are fine, then I want to take you to Bangalore. I will put you into a residential school, college kind, okay? I will pay for all your expenses. But you should never fail in the examination. You should never fail in any examination. The day you fail, because that's the way I always tell them, so that they should not lose incentive. I will not help. And she said, fine. And next day I went and met principal, because in our country, principal is not only just principal. He also knows all your social things at home. Oh, father, how he died, mother, how he died, father drank and died, how mother died, how grandmother is old, what's her age, all social details you can get it from the principal or the school teacher. It's not like 9-to-5 job, it's 24/7. So I got convinced that's true. Then I brought her and I told one organization whom I said, you put this girl and every month we'll pay. Chitra did, Pooja Chitral is her name. She did very well in her examination. 10th and 12th, she got very good score. She got a seat. I told, you study whatever you want. You study whatever you want. Once in a year she has to meet me, or twice a year, with her mask card. And to take her, actually, first I have to get her dress, because she did not have dress to wear and come to Bangalore. Chappals and slippers she did not have. Everything I had to buy for her, because she comes from such a poor family, so difficult for her even to buy. And Chitra now finished her software engineering in a good college, got a software job. Maybe she's here, I don't know now, because I not met Chitra for the last 6 months, but she's doing exceedingly well. Whenever I meet Chitra, I always think, how nice, how fortunate I am. In my country, I can make the difference. How fortunate I am. I come across those people who really require our help. How fortunate I am. They give me an opportunity to serve my fellow human beings. We cannot change the situation, but we can help them to come out of it. I don't do any poverty alleviation program, but I always believe education can remove poverty. I just want to conclude my talk. A friend of mine had a habit of always complaining. You tell anything, she will complain. Once, I was waiting for an auto rickshaw in Bangalore. She asked me, why you don't have, why are you standing for an auto rickshaw? I said, when you have two drivers, the probability of both taking leave is very high. Then she told me, she'll give me a lift. And while traveling by road, she went on complaining, Bangalore roads are very bad. You should tell Chief Minister, as if Chief Minister of Karnataka listens to me. I said, okay. Then she told my, I said, how are your children? She said, oh, my son is in US, but his children cannot speak Kannada. Kannada is our mother tongue. They speak only in English. Then I said, he should not be in US, he should be in Karnataka. For that matter, people in Karnataka speak more English than most people. So then I asked, how is your hospital? She said, oh, hospital patients are troubling too much. She went on telling me many things. I said, if I stay with her for longer duration, I will also become negative, so let me get out. So I told her, hey, I want to tell you some story, because being a teacher, I always like to tell stories. I said, the Mother Earth is full of dust and mud. I have a dust allergy. So what I should do? Cover the earth with a leather or wear a pair of slippers. Which is better? She said, slippers is better. In life, you cannot change people. You cannot change others' attitude. If you want to be happy, you have to change your attitude. Then only you can be happy. You can always complain about India is illiterate, poor people, below the poverty line, etc. You can talk. You can also talk good things about gratitude, affection, sharing, talking. You can talk whichever you want. And I talk the best things which I have known, that there, my compassion is not important, but they have given me an opportunity to serve my own countrymen. She told me, who taught this lesson? Don't believe all these people who teach you. The person who taught this lesson, I want to meet that person, she told me, my friend. I said, I wish I could have taken you to that person who taught this lesson. Unfortunately, he is not alive. He was born in India 2500 years back. Born as a prince, became a monk. And when he was born, we called him Siddhartha. When he became a monk, we called him Gautama Buddha. Thank you for patient hearing. Oh, yes.
Thank you so much for sharing these really wonderful and moving reflections with us. We'll take some questions now. Veena.
You've told us a lot of different stories today about the different experiences that you've had. And I guess my question for you is how you keep from being overwhelmed by all of this, how you keep going when you see so many really sad things, you see so many really great things that you've told us about, but how do you keep hopeful?
Initially you find it hard, you know, when you see any difficult situation, you feel like crying, you feel helpless, you get upset on people. When something nice happens, then you feel very nice. But you cool down over a period of time. Then it doesn't matter. You know, actually, you always look more objectively. Look, here is the situation. Can I correct it in my own way? If it is possible, try to correct it. So this you learn over a period of time, and equanimity, which is again taught in our own scripture, that it says, never become too elated, never become too depressed. Or it's also taught in Buddha's Madhyama, that's the middle path. Always go in the middle path. Don't be excited, you know, enormous happiness, enormous sadness, no. Then you take it more objectively and say, what best I can do in these circumstances? That's all. Yeah.
Thank you. Another question? Tom Khalil.
What's the culture of philanthropy in India, both on the individual side and also the corporate side? Is it still a relatively new development, or are you beginning to see more wealthy individuals and companies embrace an obligation to help those who are less fortunate than themselves?
Actually, traditionally, individual philanthropy was in a very small way and more on a religious basis, like, okay, I will build a temple, I will build a mosque, I will build a church. And I will feed my own fellow human beings, my own community people. This thing gets a philanthropy. But since 70, 80 years, the concept has changed, because the House of Tatas started the first philanthropic, or a well-known philanthropic organization known as the Tata Trust. And there's a book on that, For the Love of It. Somebody asked Jamshedji Tata, why did you start Tata Trusts, you know, which were independent of the religion, caste, creed, language. Okay, that's a basic philanthropy. So he said, for the love of India. So for this concept came about 70, 80 years back. And off late, because of the software boom and all, you know, there are a lot of wealthy people, and people would like to give, actually. Now they want to make a family trust and give. And corporate houses are very keen to have CSR, Corporate Social Responsibility Foundation, trust. They would like to do that one. They consider it's a very essential part of businesses to have a CSR. This is growing nowadays. I have seen in our own company, our youngsters donate much more than the older generation, you know. And many youngsters are very keen. They say, like how today you are talking, that I want to take 1 year off and can I work with you 1 year? I said, you can work with 1 year, but I cannot guarantee you after 1 year, you'll go back to Infosys, because Infosys doesn't give 1 year leave. And I have come across many bright kids. They say, you know, particularly when they are very successful, they say, some percent of their income they would like to give. That kind of a charity, I'm seeing it a lot. And when tsunami struck South India, I had 100 volunteers who said, we'll take without salary leave and work with you. I said, I can't manage 100, you know, because I have to get them food. And tsunami time, you don't get food, you know, maybe one meal a day or something. Sometimes you don't get even a meal because you have to whole day work there. So I said, 25 batch is enough. So you do get people who would like to work, people they would like to donate. And every corporate house is thinking of a CSR one or another way, because if you don't do, then it's considered a bad culture nowadays.
Namaskara. It's really lovely to hear stories back home, because I'm from Karnataka, so you brought home back for me. One question, though, having worked for the past 10 years in Karnataka with children and women, I'm deeply disturbed by the growing communalization of both education and non-educational opportunities for children, but also women and men. And I feel that that's one of the very major factors for lack of access, as you know. And I'm wondering what the Infosys Foundation particularly looks at when working with schools to make sure that the plural culture that Buddha and others talk about is promoted.
So, unfortunately, in India, religion becomes one of the weapons in the politician's hand. So, anything which is advantage to them, they use religion as a weapon, and that destroys a lot of social work or good interaction which we have built for a long time. It can be destroyed in a day by one incident. It happens. But we don't have any control on that, because that is in democratic country, like large democratic country like ours, where, you know, community plays vote banks. People like us do not have anything to control that. So we are helpless. From Infosys Foundation, we work. Suppose I go to any other school, then it will be a problem, because, oh, she belonged to this community, she went to that school. So I work only with the government schools. It doesn't come under anybody. So we do only with the government schools. We also supply books to the libraries, which are very useful to understand India's culture, communal harmony. And we've always lived in harmony from so many years. So we choose that kind of good books and non-textbooks and supply to government school libraries. We have done 20, such library, we have done 12,000 in Karnataka alone. It took 10 years for us. Then we also go and check them, whether the children are reading or not. As much as possible, we would like to do that, but we are not as powerful as politicians are. After all, we are social workers. So our power is limited, and we have our own limitations. Where they are more powerful to destroy, in particular in destruction. Yes,
please. I'm curious about what you think about the role for computer science in the ability to affect the poor? It's something that we work on pretty hard here at Berkeley.
Actually, when I used to, when I'm working with children in the village area, I always ask this question: hey, do you want to learn computer? Everyone says yes, we want to learn computer. Every child says, and they, you know, the local language in that state is so different. So I wrote 3 or 4 children book for computers. You know, what is an internet? What is a computer? How can they write programs, etc.? Then you also give computers to so many schools, but it's such a large state. So even though you give thousands of computers of no use, we require some 25,000 computers. As much as possible, this year we have given more than 500 new computers in the university area, in the backward area we have given, so that, you know, there will be a batch of students who can come, children can come, and we also pay for the teachers. We take teachers, teach them basic things. Particularly, I tell them, okay, children, no, teach them computer games first. Let them get fascinated, then programming, all those. So in some area we choose, there we buy computers, there we give computers, we give computer books, we give, pay for the teachers. But we are not able to make it entire state. It is hard for us because it's a huge state. But we want that they should get used to computer, and that helps them a lot later part of their life. We want that.
If I can just follow up on that, what do you think these children will use the computers for later?
Normally what happens, you know, these children are from the government schools. And we provide a computer, but government, we also tell government that we provide computers. And we also pay for these teachers who are 12th class or something. Government should not interfere. In the sense, government should not say tomorrow, you have used our staff. You know how the bureaucracy in India, it's not that simple. Okay, somehow you should study, it's not there. No, it's, they are very conscious about their powers. So you tell, we will employ somebody, after the school hours they will come, Saturday, Sunday they will teach. Government has said okay for us. And these children, we identify those potential schools, not every school. In a district level potential school where brighter children come and poorer brighter children come, and there if you identify the students are very good, then in that area we give scholarship in the school also, come up to 12th level, and if they get good marks then we pay to their graduation. We have done that, but it's a hard work, constant follow up, but teachers help us in that work, and we help teachers in small monetary way. More than that, many children have done this one, you know, that they were interested. Out of 100, maybe 10, 20 will do well. But still, it's a good percentage.
Good evening, ma'am. Having grown up idolizing you and Mr. Murty, I think it's a privilege for me to be in the same room as you today. I work for a corporate foundation, and I really appreciate your feedback in terms of the whole value chain, in terms of the grant assessment process, the impact measurement process. You touched on it really well in terms of the individual impact assessment. How do you recommend corporations approach this for social impact assessment in a community or in a host government where we operate, typically in the extractive business?
In India, I'm talking with respect to India, I can talk. See, when you give money, many people think that's the end of your philanthropy. Actually, many times it's the cause of, root cause of misery many times. So you should assess a project. That's the way we do. Assess a project first. Depending on the project, you should give money. For example, all scholarship programs, you give 80% money, not 100%. I said, I will put 80. Let him get, or let her get 20. There are exceptions are there. For example, sex workers' children, we give 100% money. Okay, rest of that 80% money. And in health project, you know, every project has a different yardstick how much money you should give. Health project, we don't encourage individual help. Rarely we do that, exceptional case. But normally we want to go for a larger extent. For example, Shankaran Netralaya, there is a very famous eye hospital in Bangalore is coming up. 60% paid, 40% unpaid. So we said we are responsible for the 40% unpaid. We build that building, we do everything for that 40% unpaid. Or the equipment we buy for the unpaid people, so that many people are benefited. When you do philanthropy, your strategy, that is the way we have followed. Many people should be helped than a few individuals. Few individuals we don't do. Then we have the follow-up, regular follow-up. Any project you do, you'll have four. We don't read reports. They will send reports, but we don't read reports. Reports, I can write anything. In our country, we can write anything. I said, I should go and see that. What may? No. In case they have done well, that's fine. If case they have not done, why they have not done well? Where did they go wrong? Is it because of their laziness? Or is it because they have not understood the problem? So always we require a constant follow-up. And then only we do the next grant. Any grant we divide into 3 to 4 parts. First phase we will give. Go and check, come back. And then we have always a remark column. And depending on that, we give the next grant. In any administration, actually in any work, out of 100%, 60 to 70% actually, or 50 to 60% is all administration, follow-up, check, verification. About 20% is execution of the giving money, and that 20% is extra, depending on the circumstance, which we don't know that way.
No, I think my question has already been answered.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, it was all about, from what you had said, there was a one side of a hard taskmaster and the other side of compassion.
You have so, to have both.
Yeah.
If you are always compassionate, people will take you on a ride, you know. They will tell me 100 stories. If you are always hard, then you can't make it. Okay? We tell in our Sanskrit literature, it says, you should be like a diamond, very strong. Vajradapi kathorani. You should be as hard as a diamond at times. Mruduni kusumadapi. You should be as soft as a flower is. And you have to learn this both qualities, you know, when you do philanthropy. You should be compassionate, but also hard taskmaster.
Shen.
What's been your experience, positive and negative, of the role that the government has played in your kind of work?
We don't work with government at all, so no role. We avoid to work. Sometimes we work, but we don't bother much about them. In the sense, we have built government hospitals, okay? We have done, but we prefer to work with the poorest of the poor directly without any agency, with our own employees or our volunteers. Or sometimes we have teachers non-profit organization, we have formed teachers non-profit organization, we help them through them. But by and large we don't do, because there will be a lot of hurdles there, you know, and misinterpretation. Then the moment they know we are doing well, the person who is in charge of the government will be transferred immediately. All those hassles. I said, why have, without that also we have done all these years.
I feel that Bill Gates Foundation and, you know, there are many other this kind of trust which like they give so much money for AIDS project in India, and celebrities like Richard Gere and they all also come into picture, and because of that some problems come into better limelight. So according to you, since you are living in India and since you are in, you know, better touch with all the people and problems there, what do you think, I mean, which are the areas that need urgent attention? And healthcare or rural development or education?
It is like this, you know. Which part of the body is important, if you ask? When your legs are paining, you say leg is important. Your hands are paining, you say hands are important. Which part of the body is important? It's very difficult to say. Same way, we have many problems in India. And they're all interconnected. Health is not important. No, of course, a healthy person only can do better work. Is education not important? If there is no education, people never come out of the poverty line. Rural development is not important. Yes, it is important. So, they are, according to me, all are equally important. But the most important, according to me, is the population. If we reduce our population and we educate them, many problems can be solved easily.
We'll take one last question.
You have a very special view of what's happening in India, and I would like to know, where do you see country going, what are your aspirations for the country, and where do you see country to be in, say, 20 years?
Actually, I don't, please, I don't visualize that way, because there are many, you can talk that with respect to business, they will tell 20 years what is the GDP will be there or what is our turnover will be there, they can tell. In philanthropy, I cannot say after 20 years what happens, because there are many unforeseen circumstances will affect the social life. However, in my experience, the dire poverty in India has disappeared, in state of Karnataka at least, in some, many states actually. Still it is there in some states, like Bihar it is there, Uttar Pradesh it is there, Rajasthan it is there. But down the south, the dire poverty has disappeared. You know, thanks to education or government, some good policies are there. Some of the policies are very good. For example, in Karnataka government, if the child, when a female child is born with the LIC, they have a new scheme, they deposit some 10,000 rupees or something. New policies have come. Free education is there, midday meal is there. So, the state of Karnataka, Maharashtra and Gujarat. Order is first Gujarat. Anyone is from Gujarat here? Okay. Gujarat is number one state in India where all social projects are doing exceedingly well. Because the legacy of Gujarat is different than Bihar. Gujarat is a state which has produced Mahatma Gandhi, Vallabhbhai Patel, Mani Ben, and now Seva, Ilaben Bhatt. So Gujaratis have that mindset of improving themselves. And that state has done very well in terms of social work than any state. Out of my 8 national disasters, Gujarat is the only state where they recovered very fast compared to any other natural disasters because they want to improve. And maybe their outlook in life is so different that they work together, they share, they live simple life, they never show off. You can't make out when you go to any function who is rich, who is poor in Gujarat because all of them wear more or less a similar kind of sari. You go down south and you go to Bihar, you can make out who is rich, who is poor immediately. Their language, their, you know, the way their weddings are conducted. That simplicity of Gujarat has made it very prosperous in terms of social activity. I rate it number one in India. Number two is Maharashtra. Anyone is from Maharashtra? You are there. Maharashtra is number two. Again, the state of Maharashtra is a different culture. It was Savitribai Phule, Agarkar, Maharshi Karve. Elderly people have led a life of an exemplary life and leaders were of great quality. That helped the subsequent generation to do better, particularly a place like Pune where they are always ahead of time. They are always ahead of time, Pune, because there is a widow remarriage in 1896. I mean, it may look very silly thing in the West, but in our country it means a lot in 1896. So the state leaders can make a great difference in the social activity. Karnataka also. So dire poverty of these three states have disappeared. Of course something else has creeped in. But 20 years again, what state I should talk? Because please remember in India, when I talk about India, I can't talk about India as a whole. The average may be something else. 20 years in Gujarat is different, 20 years in Karnataka is different, 20 years in Maharashtra is different. 20 years in Bihar, I don't know any change may happen or may not happen at all. Maybe it reverse, I do not know. Gujarat, Bihar, Rajasthan, Bimaru they call, Madhya Pradesh is still better. So I cannot generalize for all states in India, but I can tell some states can do very well. Gujarat will definitely do well. Maharashtra will do well. Karnataka will do well. Tamil Nadu will do well. In terms of health, Tamil Nadu is number one. In terms of health, Tamil Nadu is well. In terms of education, and all, Gujarat is number one. Or cooperative movement, Gujarat is number one. So every state has some, in terms of education, Kerala is number one. So though Bengalis are, there may be many Bengalis here, though Bengalis are very fond of literature and art and education, but Bengal will not do very well in education because there is a divide there, whereas Kerala there is no divide. Due to political reasons, there is no divide there. In Bengal, you can see utter poverty, and maybe due to Bangladesh people have come there, that could be one of the reasons. But Kerala and Bengal, I can always compare in terms of the women empowerment because women are very strong in those states, Bengal and Kerala. Thanks to my work, I could read people if they are from that state, what are the characteristics by and large. But in terms of education, both are not equal. Kerala is better. So it goes by state, I can tell you. But not all over India, I will not be able to tell. And philanthropy has taught me a great lesson. What you do not know, tell, I do not know. You don't have to say, I know everything.
And on that note, thank you once again for the privilege of hearing you talk.